Hello, my name is Kapil Katyal. Thank you all for coming. Today I'm gonna talk about vision restoration using retinal prosthetics. This is a project that I've been working on with a handful of people throughout the lab for about 3 or 4 years now. My background in the lab is I've been here for about 10 years. I work in the intelligence systems group within the research organization. My background is in computer science and electrical engineering, and my current role right now is a project manager for this project. So this project is, basically the goal is to, as the first line says, basically restore vision for people who have a condition known as retinitis pigmentosa. So this is a degenerative disease. This is a disease that basically over time you have damaged rods and cones within your eye, and that basically affects either partial or total vision loss. And this is a condition that affects 1 in 4,000 individuals within the world. And basically, this is a project that we're working in collaboration with Second Sight Medical Products. So this is a small company that's based out in Los Angeles, California, where they basically have developed a retinal implant device. And basically what this is it's a device that sits on the retina, and it projects information to the blind individual that basically bypasses the damaged rods and cones, travels that information via the optical nerve, and basically stimulates light patterns to the visual cortex. And basically our role on this project is kind of threefold. Number one, we're developing computer vision algorithms. So as you and I walk around, as able-bodied individuals walk around, we have a plethora of information and visual stimulation that we're constantly seeing. But basically, how do we take that information and distill it down into something that we can present to the visual cortex? We'll talk about integrating eye tracking, why that's relevant for blind individuals. Talk about that in a future slide. And then kind of overall, how are we going to help Second Sight develop their next generation product? So here's kind of a layout of Second Sight's current product called the Argus 2. So this is consists of many components. You basically have a pair of glasses with an outward-facing camera. So this is just a simple RGB camera that takes the entire information, entire scene, and basically distills it into RGB colors. Basically, that information travels via wire to this video processing unit. This is something that the patients wear on their belt pack. And basically, it's an embedded device that basically takes the sensor data, runs the computer vision algorithms, and basically outputs a 10x6 array, so 10x6 meaning the 10x6 pixels that they're trying to present to the retinal prosthetic device. And that retinal prosthetic device sits on the retina, and as I mentioned earlier, basically transmits that information via the optical nerve to the visual cortex. So why is this a really challenging problem? The main issue right now is that the implant has the limitation of only being able to project 60 pixels. And so just to kind of get a sense of how challenging that would be, this is basically on the top left, the camera view of us walking down a corridor. This is an example of a computer vision algorithm that we would run to kind of post-process that information. And basically this is symbolic of what we're sending down to the implant, and then the brain does some blurring effect. So this is kind of what we believe the patient is seeing. And so you can imagine as you're kind of walking down and seeing all the different visual stimuli, really what you can highlight are edges, corners, those kinds of things that we can present to the patient. So the real challenge of this project is not, you know, the most sophisticated vision algorithm, it's what you don't show to the patient. You have to basically figure out what is the most relevant information in the scene for what they're trying to do. And so, you know, typical APL fashion, we didn't just go, you know, as soon as we started working on this, just start building. We really wanted to kind of understand from a patient's perspective, what were the different challenges, what were the problem areas that we could most readily develop solutions for. And so kind of talking through with the patients, going through a variety of different patient feedback stories, you know, we basically broke down kind of 4 different scenarios that we thought that we could build solutions to help address. So the first one was, you know, right now, because it's such a limited field of view, you basically have to kind of, basically you have to look around the scene. It's kind of like looking through a telescope, right? If we wanted to kind of make out a door, you'd have to kind of pan around that door over and over again until you can make out that, okay, these are all patterns of a door. Imagine doing this all the time, you know, 24 hours a day. And so what they're doing is they're basically moving their head all day long, and it's just causing fatigue. It's very awkward in terms of social interactions. And so we wanted to kind of try eye tracking to see if we could address that. The second issue is difficulty in knowing where people are when they walk into a room. They basically have to wait for verbal cues to basically know where to focus their attention. So we wanted to try to develop algorithms that could basically detect faces automatically. Finding objects on a table, because it's only 60 pixels and you have a table full of objects, it's really difficult to know exactly where the objects are and how do I quickly locate the objects that I'm interested in. And then the last one that I kind of wanted to mention, this is sort of on the horizon of things we're going to do on the research side, but you know, going to an unstructured environment like a library, how do you, you walk into the building, you may want to go to the restroom, or you may want to walk back to the exit sign. Right now, they have to rely on human intervention. They have to ask for assistance because they can't navigate back. But how can we build algorithms that can basically assist them in the navigation in unstructured environments? So I'm going to talk mostly about the top three because that's kind of what we've done to date. The fourth bullet is sort of what we're doing ongoing, and hopefully we'll have an opportunity to talk more about that in a future date. So eye tracking, the goal here, as I mentioned, we want to reduce head fatigue. We want to reduce awkwardness and interaction. And so the issue here is you basically have a restricted field of view. And so how do we move that field of view? How do we move that naturally without them having to move their head? Well, how do we do it? How do we, as able-bodied people, do it? We move our eyes constantly. We're constantly looking left, right. It's called a saccade. And so the idea was, can we integrate eye tracking into the next generation pair of glasses so that the blind individuals can actually move their eye, and as they move their eye, they're changing that field of view. And so basically, they're preventing them from having to move their head to kind of move that field of view within the scene. And so we've done a series of experiments with this. So basically, we had several patients who've had this procedure basically follow moving objects within a scene, and we tested both with eye tracking and without eye tracking, and we basically demonstrated through a variety of different analysis we demonstrated 70% reduction in head motion. So we did this by basically putting an inertial measurement unit, an IMU, on the head, and so we can track the actual motion of the head throughout the test. And so doing these kinds of experiments, we're basically helping Second Sight get quantifiable metrics to say, okay, there is a justifiable reason for adding the expense of eye tracking into the eyeglasses, because 70% is fairly significant in terms of reducing the amount of head fatigue. So the next thing was, we wanted to address was face detection. So again, you walk into a room, how do you know where the people are? And so right now, with the vision algorithms, we're just showing edges and corners, as I showed in that previous video. What we wanted to do is be able to allow the users to switch to different modes. So here we can switch to basically a face detection mode. And it's not enough to just be able to detect faces. You want to cue them towards where the faces are. And so what we've developed is this cueing mechanism so that when the face is not within the field of view, you basically just see this white bar that's kind of guiding them to tell them, while you're not looking at the face right now, if you looked in this direction, this is where you would see the face. And then as soon as you hover over the person, you switch over to showing features of the face so that they can try making out who that person might be. And so we tested this with pretty good feedback. These kinds of algorithms are going to be basically on the next generation version of Second Sight product as downloadable filters. So different people may have different needs, different algorithms that they want to use, and so basically be able to download this as a capability for their existing device. So the next thing we wanted to address was object recognition. So this is, you're looking at a table, you've got four or five objects on that table. How do I know exactly where my mug is or where my phone is? And so what we're doing is we're taking state-of-the-art computer vision algorithms. So we, at the lab, have already been doing computer vision and object recognition for a variety of different domains. And so what we basically did was take some of that work, and we looked at kind of what is the state of the art. And so on the left here is sort of the state of the art, where there's really no temporal consistency. And what I mean by temporal consistency, frame to frame, you could see that it does a good job detecting, but it drops out over time. And so what we did was we added basically a common filter to kind of stabilize from frame to frame so that we can basically keep track of those objects, because as you can imagine, if things go in and out while they're trying to search for objects, that would be very distracting for the patient. So basically, we took that and we basically...
Show me the remote.
Looking for remote.
There it is. Awesome.
Right on.
Good job. Again, try saying... Okay.
Show me the cup.
Looking for cup.
Can I see it?
Yep, you can start scanning.
I've got it.
Yep. Awesome.
I like her.
She's helpful. Like her. When can I buy her?
So you can see that, you know, this is a blind individual, obviously. So she previously had a lot of difficulty in those kinds of tasks. And, you know, if you can basically filter out all the different things that you had that you would normally show her and just show her the object that she's looking for, use that same cueing mechanism that we used for face detection, basically we're able to, you know, help her locate those objects really quickly. And, you know, these kinds of technologies, I mean, a lot of this we actually had already in-house, right? We were just finding the right people, knowing that that capability exists, integrating into this project. I mean, I would love to say that this was a complex effort. It really wasn't that much work, but you could see the amount of impact. So, you know, going to John's point, it's just, you know, finding what capabilities we have in the lab, applying it to different scenarios can make a huge impact. So, you know, where we are right now, we're basically in the patient testing phase. We've, you know, prototyped a lot of these algorithms. We've developed, more than just prototypes. We've actually integrated some of these algorithms into their existing product. But we're really looking to, at least Second Sight is looking at APL for more on the research side of things. You know, how do we push their next generation product? How do we basically take things like the, you know, going to unstructured environments and presenting information that's basically most relevant to what they're trying to do? We're also looking at, you know, a wide variety of patient populations. So I mentioned the retinitis pigmentosa is the only condition that currently works for this for the product that Second Sight has, and that is 1 in 4,000. But if you can basically go into the cortical, like the visual cortex directly, so bypass the retina, go directly into the visual cortex, now you can start treating things like age-related macular degeneration, glaucoma, trauma, very important for our military. Now you can really increase your patient population, and you can basically target, you know, 1 in 20 people in the U.S. that have some kind of condition like this. And so, you know, expanding the patient population with this technology, I think, is a really critical step, next step for this, for what we're doing. And, you know, in terms of our contributions, you know, it's been a great collaboration because, you know, on one side we're doing the research, but having an industry partner, you know, to actually go and deploy some of these solutions has been really rewarding, as you can see from the patient testing, being part of that, you know, getting that one-on-one feedback. And, you know, it really does motivate you to try to come up with the next algorithm that could then be a big change for what they want to be able to accomplish. So with that said, I want to thank you for attending, and thanks.